In 2012, Disney released their big-budget adaptation of Edgar Rice Burroughs' John Carter of Mars books, the first time, the second-ish time that the books had been turned into films. At least the first time that didn't have papier-mâché masks. Anyway, I'd been a fan of the books for years, even before I read them. They'd been lying around the house, and many members of my family had read them and carefully explained how everything that came out since had ripped them off. Hell, even Star Wars owes its existence to these books. Star Wars was a better version of them, too. I had finally decided to start reading the books a couple of years before the movie actually came out, when it was officially in production, and I was hoping to be that hipster guy in high school who read the books before they were cool. I remember meeting an old guy at the comic shop and instantly bonding over reading them. Sadly, it turned out that the books weren't cool for my generation. If you really want to see my whole perspective on these books, check out my History of Science Fiction. You might find a video or two that you like. I could get into why the film failed, how it was over-budgeted and poorly marketed. For instance, did you know that they cut the title John Carter of Mars because it was a movie called Mars Needs Moms that was a complete flop? Yeah, because it had Mars in the title. I mean, they couldn't call it John Carter of Barsoom, but I digress. Yes, the film doesn't really follow the book that it's based on, and it's not like it's a complicated story. In fact, the problem is they overcomplicated something that was beautiful in its simplicity. And the actors are just terrible.
Captain John Carter, Virginia.
But even from the first few ads that I saw of the film, I knew something was wrong. It was right in the look of the movie. The aesthetic was completely off. Now, I understand that every reader will have a different interpretation of the book and how it looks and what the characters are and so forth. It's really one of those beautiful things about reading, the subjectivity of it all. But one of Burroughs' skills as a writer was the clarity that he brought to his work and how different artists from different generations have realized his images. I mean, they're all similar, yet subtly different. The world of John Carter is one of age-old chivalry, going back ages to medievalism and orientalism. You're supposed to get this sense of adventure and mysticism that was the prevailing art style of the time. Look at these pictures. Look how modern everything looks, like it's ripping off recent science fiction films. The aliens are weird and cartoony looking. I mean, not just because they're CGI, like their proportions are just silly when you think about it. I'll get to the CGI bit later. Like, look at these things. In the book, they're supposed to be literally eight-legged horses. Okay? I mean, I can understand you dress them up and make them look like alien horses from space. But they look like lame cartoon dinosaurs. Like I said, it's beauty in simplicity, not do whatever the hell you want. Another thing that just looked off was this character. And I said character, damn it! Wula was one of my favorite creatures in the book for being a symbol of love and loyalty, even in the most dire of circumstances. He was kind of like Chewbacca. In fact, he was almost exactly like Chewbacca.
Chewie!
Anyway, while I don't flat out hate his design, it's still just too cutesy, I guess. It was clearly designed more to sell toys than to be something badass and awesome. I could really go on about everything in the film this way, from the way the cities look, to the mere fact that they're wearing clothes. Oh yeah, they knew how to party back then. But two things really stand out to me. One, the spaceships. In the original stories, the ships were like those little skiff things from Star Wars, remember? In fact, the entire opening scene of Return of the Jedi is straight out of John Carter. Just change the names around and you're golden. They also had, like, pirate ships, you know, like with sails and things that kind of flew through the air. Their sails were solar-powered. See, it was like a mix of new and old. Well, the hell with that. Just throw some generic-looking spaceships in there. It looks like something from another movie. No reason to stand out and be memorable at all. The kiddies will love that. The other thing, and it's a big thing, are, well,
this is a white ape.
What the hell is this? Again, in the book, they're literally gorillas.
You're more than that. Give me one.
With four arms. And white fur. They're kind of like Tarzan apes. It's part of the Barsoom atmosphere, how everything looks like it comes from Earth, but slightly altered to give the appearance that it's alien and foreign. Yeah, you could argue it might be a little cheesy and even downright silly when you think about it. But so is everything else in the movie! Jesus Christ! From a story perspective, it pissed me off too. In the film, they keep the white apes in the arena like gladiator animals, whereas in the book they were semi-intelligent and kind of wandered around doing whatever the hell they wanted. Even on Mars, they were weird creatures on the edge of existence. They kept these big-ass elephant monsters in the arena for people to fight, not the freaking apes. But like I said, I don't want to focus on how the film deviated from the book, but it just pissed me! Sorry about that. So, about that blasted CGI. I HATE IT! I HATE IT! I HATE IT! Ah, man. I'm really hitting the pills hard today. Anyway, yeah, CGI sucks. Yes, I know there's a lot of hard work and effort that goes into it, and it costs an arm, a leg, a kidney, hell, even a kid! But when used incorrectly, all that beautiful work goes to waste. I maintain my stance that if it ain't there, it ain't there. How can an actor work off of a character whom he can't see, hear, feel, touch, or interact with in any way whatsoever? Shut up, that doesn't count. But if you want to ignore the actor interaction, the emotional engagement, the fact that CGI threw the budget into huge proportions, I think the main reason to do it with traditional effects is for tradition. I mean, John Carter is the genesis of modern science fiction, the story that created epics and adventures on Mars, harkening back to classic mythology and introducing readers to a world all too similar to the one they know. Not only Star Wars, and Avatar, and Star Trek, and Aliens, and Lord of the Rings, and Superman, and Batman, and Marvel Comics, and the Rocky Horror Picture Show, and Game of Thrones, and Godzilla can all claim their lineages to John Carter. But pretty much every special effects movie ever made in some way has to draw it back to Edgar Rice Burroughs. The film could have been a love letter to the history of filmmaking, incorporating a century's worth of effects into its tapestry. Ray Harryhausen had been contacted about making a John Carter film, and you can clearly see the influence of the books upon the man. He would have been perfect. Hell, he was still alive at the time the movie was made. He could have had something to do with it. Even Ray Bradbury was still alive. He could have prevented this crap, and I hate Ray Bradbury! Okay, hate's a strong word. If I had been given $263 million, I would have included everything I could think of, from rotoscoping, to suitmation, to stop motion, to CGI itself, to miniatures, to marionettes, to motion capture, to matte paintings, to real actual sets, to even location filming, to classic eye lighting, to Bronson Cave, to hubcaps on strings, to tilting the camera on its side, to whatever the hell this thing is. There's so much they could have done, but no, they just wanted to rip off a movie that was technically worse and hope people liked it. Yeah, I actually like this movie better than Avatar. Bite me. Now, you might be saying that I'm allowing myself to be too influenced by the earlier images of John Carter, and I'm just seeing him through others' eyes. And you're right. That's really the whole point I'm making. There's a huge wealth of information to draw from, old pictures and images, actual pulp magazines that featured the character, the numerous other films I've already mentioned. Yes, they're trying to do something new with it, but I don't get this sense that it's an intelligent, this is my interpretation kind of thing. It's more, let's make it cool looking. The film could have been like a Pulp Fiction cover come to life, especially with the old school special effects. And that's the real tragedy of this movie. It was a chance to bring audiences back to a time of high adventure and classic and even nostalgic yearnings for the past, when saving the damsel in distress was what mattered, and being loyal to your friends was more important than a body count you racked up. It could have opened up a new generation of filmmaking, and maybe spurred on more creative directorial efforts than just generic Hollywood schlock. Much like Edgar Rice Burroughs before them, they could have defined the coming century and retaught the world the meaning of adventure. Or at the very least, I hope they haven't already done that and squandered the creative powers, leaving them to wither on the burning sands. Oh, wait, hold up. There was one last thing I wanted to mention. In the movie, despite the fact there were numerous bedtime scenes and scenes at night, there was no verbal or even visual mention of sleeping silks and furs. What the hell? I might have forgiven everything if it weren't for that. How can you have John Carter without sleeping silks and furs? It's just not John...